In this video, we are going to talk about applications of Laplace transform, and we have around five different applications of Laplace transform, and these are the ones that we are going to study in our course, but there are definitely more applications, but you need to study other courses in order to see the other application. So the first application that is useful of Laplace transform is that we can use it in order to solve or analyze circuits, in order to do circuit analysis, okay? And we can do circuit analysis using Laplace transform in two different ways that we'll see in the next video probably. The first way is to model the circuit elements in the S domain, to model the capacitor and the inductor as like some circuit elements using the S domain, and then use the models that we use for the capacitor and inductor in order to solve the circuit. And the second way is just, if I give you a circuit, you write the differential equation of the circuit. After you write the differential equation, you can solve the differential equation easily in the S domain, because solving the differential equation in the S domain, as we explained before, it converts the differential equation into a simple algebraic equation. And once we go to the S domain, we will have a simple algebraic equation, we can solve it easily. After we solve it, we will have to go back to the time domain. So after we solve whether the circuit in the S domain using the circuit model of the elements, or using the differential equation and solving this differential equation in the S domain, we need to do inverse Laplace transform. So we need to do inverse Laplace transform. Also, when we do the circuit element, when we do the circuit analysis, we include all the initial conditions. And this is why the Laplace transform is useful in the circuit analysis, because it takes into account the initial conditions. When we turn the switch on or off, it takes the initial conditions into account, okay? But anyways, after we solve the circuit in the S domain, we'll have to do inverse Laplace transform. The second application that we'll see in the future videos is we can, from the differential equation of a system, if I give you a system and you write the differential equation of this system, you can calculate the transfer function h of s, which represents the relation between y of s over x of s in case of LTI systems. And after we calculate the transfer function h of s, we can also calculate the impulse response h of t using the inverse, again using the inverse Laplace transform. So from the differential equation, we can transform it using Laplace transform into an algebraic equation in the S domain. We transform the differential equation into algebraic equation using Laplace transform. Then we can calculate the transfer function h of s, which is basically y of s over x of s, the output in the S domain over the input in the S domain. Then we can do inverse Laplace transform to obtain the impulse response h of t. So we can use Laplace transform to obtain the transfer function and the impulse response easily. But again, in order to get the impulse response, you need the inverse Laplace transform. One important note here for this application that we'll discuss later is we have to assume all initial conditions. To be zero, all initial conditions to be zero. In order for our system to be linear, all initial conditions must be zero. If the initial condition is not assumed to be zero, then the system will not be linear, and all equations that we use for LTI systems will not be correct. So in order for the system to be linear, you have to assume all initial conditions to be zero. So for this application, by default, we assume all initial conditions to be zero. Otherwise, if you don't assume the initial conditions to be zero, the system will not be linear. And you can go back and see in the linearity video that we studied in the beginning of the course, when we had a system with a constant addition, like let's say that y of t was equal to x of t plus 6. We found that this system, because of the 6, we found that this system was not linear. Because of this 6, and you can go and review this example, the system was not linear because of this constant 6, which represents here initial conditions. So this example shows you that if you have non-zero initial condition, okay, then the system will not be linear. Okay, so by default, if we assume that we are dealing with linear systems and we want to use these equations and the convolution equations, okay, which are valid only for linear systems, we have to assume by default, we have to assume that all initial conditions to be zero. The third application is sometimes they give you the impulse response of the system and you have the input and you want to calculate the output. So the default is to say that the output is the convolution between the input and the impulse response. But sometimes the convolution, doing the convolution, the time domain is difficult. That's why Laplace transform might be useful here, because Laplace transform says that y of s will be equal to x of s multiplied by h of s. So you can, instead of doing convolution in the time domain, you can do multiplication, direct multiplication in the s domain by taking the Laplace transform of the h, taking the Laplace transform of the x, and then you do direct multiplication, you will get y of s. But after you get y of s, in order to get y of t, you need to do what? You need to do inverse Laplace transform in order to get y of t. So in all the cases so far, we need to do inverse Laplace transform, okay? So here we went to the s domain, and then we'll go back from the s domain to the time domain using inverse Laplace transform. The fourth application is finding the frequency response of a system from h of s. So if I give you h of s, the transfer function in the s domain using Laplace transform. So for example, we calculated the transfer function h of s from here, and we want to obtain the frequency response of the system. If you remember what was the frequency response? Frequency response, we obtained it in the Fourier transform, h of omega. So we can obtain here h of omega from h of s by replacing s by j omega. So if you replace s by j omega, if you remember, we said that Laplace transform is a generalization of Fourier transform, or s equals sigma plus j omega, right? So here, if s equals j omega, which means that you take sigma basically to be zero, okay, the real part of s to be zero, then it will give you the frequency response that we used to calculate from Fourier transform. So if you replace s with j omega, then it will give you h of omega that we used to calculate from Fourier transform. And then once you obtain h of omega, you can plot the magnitude. You can plot the magnitude response and the phase response of your system. Okay, magnitude response and phase response in the frequency domain. The last application here is that from h of s, from the transfer function h of s in the s domain, we can study the system properties like the causality, the invertibility, stability. We can study these properties and identify these properties for our system from the s domain, from the Laplace transform. So these applications are the applications that are important for us at this stage that we can use the Laplace transform for. The most important one is the circuit analysis, because Laplace transform takes the initial conditions into account, which doesn't happen in Fourier transform. So circuit analysis is very important with the two ways that we are going to talk about in the next video. And then solving differential equations, identifying the transfer function impulse response, doing the convolution in the S domain, and obtaining the frequency response and the properties of the system from Laplace transform. We'll see you in the next video with the first application.